pobreza, paso del domingo. I was chasing the harbor, I satisfy my soul. All of the lies I believed in, every cry in like the rain. Then my soul lightning from heaven, and I never knew the same. I'm gonna climb a mountain, I'm gonna shout about it. I am a child of love. I found a world of freedom, I found a friend in Jesus. I am a child of love. Nothing can change the way I belong to you. Yes, I do. Nothing can separate. Nothing can change the way you love me. Nothing can change the way I belong to you. Yes, I do. Nothing can separate. Nothing can change the way you love me. Nothing can change the way I belong to you. Yes, I do. Nothing can separate. I'm gonna climb a mountain. I'm gonna shout about it. I am a child of love. I found a word of freedom. I found a friend in Jesus. I am a child of love. I'm gonna climb a mountain. I'm gonna shout about it. I am a child of love. I found a word of freedom. I found a friend in Jesus. I am a child of love.
Through these ages, you are a friend of mine. know that you cannot be shaken. I see what you can do. You are good. In the morning I'll say you are good. In the evening I'll say you are good. You are good to me.
Take a moment and say hi to one of the folks around you as we get organized today. Great, let's all come in and find our chairs. I've got my battery in the thing now, so we're good to go. All went very quiet, very quickly there. Great to see you at church. Well, we've just gotten back from holidays, so it's lovely to be back with the church family. Great to be with you all. And again, if you are visiting or if you haven't met yet, I just want to say hello. My name's Joel. Let's chat. Not now, maybe a little bit later, but it's great to see you and have you with us today. We're going to worship God with our tithes and offerings, and I know that many people give via direct debit now. Few people give by a credit card, and if that's you, I put the details on the screen of how you can do that. If you want to give by cash as well, you can in the box as well. We don't pass the old collection plates. Remember the old days of passing the plate was this sort of plate, wooden plate that had, you know, the carpet sort of laid in the middle of it, and to stop the sound of coins jingling as they hit the, you know the ones. Remember those? I remember those. And then we moved to, something a little bit more, discreet. So we've got these bags. Remember the bag that had the wooden handle on the left and the right and the little bag, you drop the thing in, and if you didn't want anyone to see what you're putting in, you put your whole hand in and then they go. And then you remember, I remember going to some conferences and they started using these garden buckets, so like a pot plant sort of bucket, what it looked like anyway. And so then you could hear everything. And so all those people that are holding coins are like, oh, maybe I should go with the $5 note instead. So, oh yeah, that's what quieter. It's so funny. Well, there's a moment I want to tell you about. I want to talk about this moment in King David's life. It's actually, I read this morning, and I thought it's a perfect thing to bring to life as we open up our scripture today. But 2 Samuel. So Samuel tells the story of Saul and David's life. It's a great, great read. There's a lot that happens in it. But, you know, some of the Old Testament are hard to read. I understand that. But this part of Samuel is good for reading. It's a story that begins to happen. But it finishes off with this fascinating little moment where David kind of is a bit grumpy and he says, he does something wrong and he counts all the people and he's not meant to count the people but he counts them anyway and God's like, you shouldn't have done that. And he's like, yeah, I shouldn't have done that. And he goes, and in the end they kind of go, okay, well, David says, I confess my sin and I want to build an altar for you. And God points him to a place where this guy, I think his name is Arwana, and this place is called Go Build the Altar Boy. And when he goes there, this guy named Arwana owns this field already, owns this area already. And David's like, oh, God told me to build an altar for him too. And this Arwana guy said, that's great, that's fantastic. Here you go, David, have my property, right? It's yours. Have my, you know, and let me get some oxen, you can worship there, and you can do some sacrifices there. And I'm excited about this, I want to be a part of this. Arwana's is very happy about this moment. It's like, he's going to get a chance to worship with the king, and follow and obey the Lord. And David says something that's really interesting. It says to him in 2 Samuel 2:2, the king answered Arwana, no. Insist on buying from you for twice. For I will not offer to the Lord my God burnt offerings that he must. And so, isn't that interesting? He wants it to cost him. He wants his worship to cost him something. It's not the cost of him. So, if we come to worship God and do our five offerings in the same way, I love us, and I'd love to. Today you are in the bubble and start out there. And the work of you and praise you. You probably have more mention that to outgive you today, but I'll be a good fit to our world. In the very beginning, you've been seeing the world that you will be. As you guys, as you give, now we have the January announcements, which are probably way out of date, but let's run them anyway! Thank you.
everybody. Well, I can't tell you how much I am looking forward to being with you in May in Singapore next year, 2024, our global gathering. I know that a fresh anointing, a new anointing, enabling us and equipping us for greater growth, increase, and enlargement is going to come upon us. We're going to increase and find ourselves being increased within, and we'll take that back into our congregations. We will expand. We will move into new nations, new cities, new towns and villages with new voices, new leaders. They're going to rise up in amongst us because of the anointing and the power of the Holy Spirit. You and I are going to be part of a brand new revolution, helping people all around this world not only discover Christ, but have full, abundant lives. And so as we come together, I know that our unity is going to cause a great new flow of that anointing oil through every one of our churches. I'm looking forward to seeing you there.
Excited about that trip. We've got about almost 10 of us going now. 9 of us are already connected and committed to going over to check that out in Singapore next year. It's going to be a lot of fun, first of all, but I do sort of see this as a bit of a moment. You see all the nations coming together, and what I love about us here, though, is that all the nations are coming to us, so we're not going out. All the nations are coming to us. And I think it's pretty cool, right? I think it's really cool. I think it's fantastic. And just so you know, like C3, that is, if you haven't got familiar with who C3 are, that video kind of gives you an idea of where we fit amongst the world now, C3. So C3 started about 40 years ago, just over 14 years ago. This church was started just around 14 years ago. So same age as C3, just about. But if you go across the world, we started here in Sydney. C3 is a Sydney-based church. Brilliant. We love to be part of that. And it's now extended into all across the world, 600 persons worldwide already, and growing. People are reaching into, right now, I know the church has been talking to Bangladesh, through Ukraine, through Russia, but you know, the Christian seeking church youth are out there, reaching people, helping people. A lot going on. We've even got a C3 church in Jordan, which is very cool. My sister just moved to the building, and so I'm looking forward to visiting her, and I'm going to be getting my C3 sendover. This is actually really, really good, because we're going to move into communion now, and as we do move into this moment, it's great to know that we are part of a large community. And I don't mean just this community with us, I mean this community plus all the C3 communities out there across the world. We get to see some of their places on the screen. And then actually, that community on the screen isn't just it, it keeps going beyond that into all of the other denominations in the world. Almost 2 billion people are part of the community of people we have today. We come walking around happily, working on every good nation, and something like 2 billion people. And that's just today, let's not add up this time. And so let me read to you what Jesus said at the Last Supper when he was just beginning. Verse 26, as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed it, and broke it, gave it to the disciples, and said, take and eat for it, this is what I do. Then he took up, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and said, drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. And I tell you, I will not drink from the fruit of the vine from now on. I just love that this one real moment, this one quiet moment that Jesus and the Holy Spirit has still a spiritual effect on the community of the whole world. It's like this moment of Jesus' prayer with those of us that are living in the world. It's all about that moment. Us and us. 2 billion other people listening to the family. Us and us. Countless billions of people from thousands, 2,000 nations from the world. Significant number.
You can have my heart. Thank you.
It's good to be in the presence of God and just be still. Don't be in a hurry. I'm trying to tick a box. Say we've achieved a thing today. But we need to be in the presence of God. We need to lift up and move and do this and clean the world. Remember, I was only 5 years old, first day of my life with the Lord. I still remember. I don't remember anything else from 5 years old. I remember walking to the front. And I remember another young sunset now. And I think it brought me to feel. Maybe I didn't understand him as a young 5 year old child. But he would be this man. God walked with me on this service. Oh, I tried to push me away a few times. God never let me go. Never gonna let me go. And I think I'm still struggling. But you need to know that he's living with you all the time. You need to know that he's still. He's the same. That's the person. You are. You're very poor. He's opening the scripture to stand at the door and knock and barge in to our direction. And take his name. Psalm 115, not to us, Lord, not to us, but to your name be glory, because of your faithfulness, because of your faith. Why should the nations say, where is their God? Our God is in heaven. He does whatever he pleases. Their idols, silver and gold, made by human hands. They have mouths but cannot speak, eyes but cannot see. They have ears but cannot hear, noses but cannot see. They have hands but cannot feel, feet but cannot walk. They cannot make a sound with their throats. Those who make justice as a whole. He is their help. House of Aaron, trust the Lord. He is their help and shield. You who fear the Lord, trust in the Lord. He is their help and shield. The Lord remembers us and blesses us. He will bless the house of Israel. He will bless the house of Aaron. He will bless those who fear the Lord, small and great alike. May the Lord add to your numbers, both yours and your children. May you be blessed by the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. The heavens are the Lord's, but the earth is given to the human. It is not the dead who praise the Lord, nor any of those descending into the silence of death, but we will hurt the best of the both now and forever. Hallelujah. Take a seat, everybody. Standing for the reading of the Word of God. Used to be a traditional thing, but we can't do it. Thank you so much, team. Wonderful. Like always. Dependable. Great. Well, today is the last of our Psalmer series. It's Psalmer time at C3 Gold. And we just love that time. I'm going to use it every year. So if you want to come and be a part of this church for the next, I don't know, however long I'm around for, get ready, get used to it. It's coming. Psalmer every summer. Sorry, I can't get used to it. So the last one today. And today we have a team preach, but it's a team of two. And the team of two is as myself. I'm going to be one of the team of two because I haven't got to preach once in the Psalmer series, and I'm kind of like, I want another one. And George is our other one. Now let's give George a warm hand, and that's going to be great. So just before we hand over to George, I'm going to ask George to come up first. Before we hand over to George, we've been away. It's good to be back. Great to see your faces again. I'm looking forward to this week. And next week, we start our vision month. So we've always sort of done February as our vision month. And so next week, starting from the first week, the first semester, literally next Sunday, and start launching our vision for the year. And I'm super excited about where we're headed with this church. I know that some of us kind of come to church and go home. If you go home, it becomes routine. But I mean, I've been doing it for 37 years. But there's a sense of anticipation. I feel it. I know others in our team feel it. But something's about to start going on through the South. I'm excited to be praying that you want to be. So next Sunday we're going to start our vision month, and each week we'll be talking about different things. And we also have a visiting speaker coming all the way from C3 Barrel, Nick Lacerdo and Jackie Lacerdo. They are great dear friends of ours, and you will love them. So make sure you're here. He is the community of community guys. Like, he used to run a pizza shop just because he loves people. An Italian man, through and through, but he's a great fun guy. So that's going to be the last of the general for us to make sure we get out of this. All right, George, over to you, mate. Psalm 115. Do you like his notes? The big one? He wants the big one. We've got big words to say. All right, George. Now, George, if you don't know George, you've met George. George is reasonably new, 6 months or thereabouts in the building, something like that. George and Christina, his wife, over here. Hello, Christina. George and Christina are regulars down at the town hall, preaching the gospel, sharing the gospel with all kinds of different people, actually. We've had at least one time visit, which was really cool. We're looking forward to more coming to visit as the next year. But that gives you an idea of who you're about to hear. So, look out! Here comes the good train.
Good morning, church. Let's bow down to the light for a few minutes. Father, we thank you for this opportunity, Father. We thank you for your love. 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 This song in particular, nobody likes to think of it. Because it's a brain shaker, it's a spirit shaker, it's a conscious shaker, it's really touched. So, personally, I don't like to preach it, but I do want to. So, just be careful, because you're going to come out different person here thinking different. Because it's not me that I'm speaking, the Holy Spirit wants to explain to us what the psalm is all about. The psalm doesn't have history. No one knows who wrote it. The psalm doesn't know when it's been written. But I know for a fact it's been written in the Passover. Israel was celebrating. The Passover is celebrating the victory of getting rid of the idol. That's the only thing we know about the psalm. Anything else, we don't know. Usually David wrote half of the psalm. Almost. Yeah. But that's one of the psalms we don't have history out of. The Bible talk about, the psalms talk about not unto us, Lord, not to us, Lord. Your name is glory. Sometimes we think, is the glory coming? Do we love to be glorified? Most of us, we like to be glorified. Most of us, they like to be tapping on the shoulder and say, put on me. When we start a year ago, probably doing outreach, we were still worried. We say, I'm not going to be good. What's going to happen tomorrow? What's going to happen next? I don't know what's going to happen. You want to be good or not? You start talking to people a week later. You start telling them that the Lord blessed us, is a lot of people getting saved, and people getting there. And you start telling people, we serve him a lot of us. Is that what you want? You want to be glorified ourselves, and glorified our family. But God doesn't want our attention to glorify ourselves. It's funny enough sometimes, a lot of times, when we glorify ourselves, it's not for attention to do that. And a lot of glorify on us, sometimes, I don't think, or nobody thinks, even if it's all most of Christians, they don't think they glorify themselves. You don't notice we are glorifying ourselves. But the glory is only to God, we serve. Even from mysteries, from kids, you glorify people. I think more than God. You love more, you give more than God, you glorify, you give more than God. Simple. If I glorify my job, more than God, I think you're glorifying, you're more than God. If I'm glorifying anything, more than God, it's God. Our God is jealous. He's very jealous. If you get to Exodus, if you don't mind putting his screen, Exodus 24. It says, you shall not make yourself an image in form of anything in heaven above, or in the earth beneath, or in the water below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I am the Lord your God. I am the jealous God. This word jealous took over a lot of people. And people think, how God can be jealous? How can God be jealous? I'm going to give you an example. And that's the apply in our life. Imagine you have a father. Imagine you have a father. Going. I'll just give an example. I can do that. She loves somebody, somebody father more than yourself. You will be jealous. Imagine your own kids love somebody more than you, and listen to them more than you, and love them more than you. What's your reaction? You will be jealous. And that's a holy jealousy. It's not very jealous. It's holy jealousy. And that's what God is about, because He is. He created us. He loved us so much. He can see. We are going somewhere else to worship. We're going somewhere else to love more than Him. And every time we've gone on something in our life, if you love a child or a wife or anything more than Him, you're going to do it. It's amazing sometimes how. That's why the engineer says that's a spirit shaker. Or something is on the face. God do what pleases me. A lot of people ask me, why God allow things happening in my life? Why do I have cancer? Or why my father had a cancer? Or why my mother had a cancer? And there's a lot of things in that. In town hall, and people coming to help them in their life, and a lot of people going to become God. Why now? Why am I asking what to do? Why this? Or why that? Or what? People ask this question, they have had to ask. Why don't I know that? You can do whatever you want, but whatever happens, you have to accept the fact God is God, and He can do whatever He wants. You allow things to happen for your benefit. It's hard to explain. In some cultures, they explain everything well. They have a way to explain it. I won't. He's sitting in a throne. So happy. He knows the past, the future, and the present all the time. He doesn't have what? Everything is past and present in the future. The seraphim and cherubim, one following the other. Holy, 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 the Lord. He knows every piece of where plant is born in your day. If anything happens to you, what happens to you, He knows about it. So make sure. You know God, you know everything, you listen to everything, and have knowledge about everything, from the past, to the present, to the future. You know about every single part of our life. There's nothing else we can do about it. Now, the most important thing I got from the time is the past. I don't have much time to talk about the other things. I'll just concentrate on the past, because how much we can trust God? You know, in fact, I was talking about this time, a lot of stuff in it. How much we can trust God? I'll give you an example. One of the first time I used to was very hard for me to take money, out of my pocket. And then, I can't trust God. I'm just going to take money with me. All my blessings, and do not enough to do it. That's how you're going to trust God. You're going to trust God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your body. You're going to trust God to a limitation, not to look bad and see yourself. Trust God. It's a word to trust is very hard. Relationship built on trust. If you don't have trust, your relationship won't last. In any situation, any circumstances, if you don't have a trust in your life, you don't get money. Especially with God. God, with God's trust is very important. You cannot have God to trust God fully. You can't have 200 things in every key open window of your life. For example, I give you just a few examples. I think of lying, fear of stealing, fear of cheating, fear of sex, fear of too many things in your life. You cannot give God 199 K and hold on in one thing. Because if you hold on in this one thing, That's God.
If you give them 199 things in your life to God, and you hold on in one,
you're not trusting God here. And God won't do it the way He's supposed to work in your life.
It's simple as that, because He said, trust me. You know how many found in His Son, the word of trust, in four,
five times. Trust. He's a new trust. You trust the Lord. You trust.
And a lot of words in the Bible, you find it really tough to understand.
Mostly sometimes we don't bless another man. That's a very strong thing. So that's a thing to open up the relationship between you and God.
Now finally you say, well, praise the Lord. With all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, with all your body.
I think it's not an example of what praising the Lord because praise the Lord as well, you say in 5-6 times.
You know the Bible says 5-6 times in the same time, or the same verse, or the same chapter. 5-6 times that you will assist and give us indication that's very important we have to do.
When you say praise the Lord, why is it praise the Lord? Why?
It's too many times happen. And I give you an example about it. When we praise the Lord, I want to important people to be studying. It's very important to God. Pretty good. It's funny enough. I put my hands out in all the work. Work is good enough. 80,000 people is working. And I think God, here's a screen and look at the new and see what's happening. And that's why stand up to God.
Everyone is going crazy.
You can't think of all the same way you're going. Jumping up and down. The praise of the Lord is all our heart. The praise of the Lord because we worship God. That's a wonderful thing. All your heart, all your mind, all your life. Forgive me if I said anything not suitable, because I'm not a preacher to preach about stuff like that. I'm a preacher, I like to preach about love, I like to preach about something positive, not negative. thanks for listening to me.
Thank you, George. That is a massive challenge, isn't it? So here's my revelation about what the scriptures are about. The scriptures are here given to us by God over the centuries of old. But they're not so easy to read sometimes. In fact, actually, sometimes they are easy to read, and other times you look at it and go, what's that about? I don't understand. But what we really need is the community together around us to understand it. We actually need to be in front of each other. I need to hear something like George from the Savior. If you trust with 99 out of 100 things and you forget the one, then you're not fully trusting God. And that's pretty serious. I need to do that. This is much more open. Okay, I think I very much push against the idea of the pastor knowing everything and the pastor being the one who got all the right answers. And if you listen to me, then you'll be good. And if you don't, you won't. That's not me, right? I push against that. And that's why. Because I know that my understanding of the scripture is mine, limited to my capacity. So when we start mixing it together with everybody else, and suddenly my life is Jesus that's on the rock. And that's why we do these teams and so on. We get more, two or three, sometimes four people coming and sharing about the same thing. I've got a few extra thoughts I'm going to just tag on to what George was saying, because I think there's something really cool here that I think that, George hinted at. I'm helping. George said, I don't like to preach negative things, but actually the scripture is not negative. It might look like it is in some ways, but it's not. If you look at verse 1, not to us, Lord, not to us, but to your name give glory. And so we look at that and we go, oh yeah, we've got to give glory to God and stop being so egotistical, stop being so prideful. We could be a bit negative on ourselves. But if we look at the next verse, it gives us the why, because there's always a why. It's like, do anything to do. So here's why. Look at the next part of that verse. Because your faithful love, because of your truth. About a week ago, I had a conversation with a dear friend, a really good friend, someone who I would, any day of the week, say yes if you said, you go grab a beer, you go grab a salad, you go grab lunch. Any day of the week, I would say yes to this friend, a good friend. They're not a Christian person. They're not a believer in Jesus. But they're someone who's interested in exploring faith and really good life and stuff. Like they love the church and the people in it. They love the way the church functions, as it, when it's called to function, as a community of love and generosity. We always have great conversations with this friend of mine. I just really love actually spending time with them. In this conversation that we had about a week ago, they made a comment, and I could see the frustration in their eyes as they said it, but they said something along the lines of this, and I'll probably spoil it since you weren't here, it doesn't matter. I tried to read the Bible, but it didn't make any sense. And I understand the frustration. There certainly are portions of the scripture that I find perplexing and confusing on 3 out of 10. I also heard something else this week. That was one conversation, but then I think God speaks to us sometimes. You know, we'll throw a seed of a conversation on day one, and then day three, something else will come up. And day seven, something else will come up. I think God wants to have a conversation. So God's having a conversation with you. This other thing I heard was when it was through a podcast that I was listening to, and that when Middle Eastern people run into the same problems we do, so whenever we come to open the scriptures, we find a problem, something that we don't like, or something we don't understand, and we see that as a perplexing problem. But a first century Middle Eastern mindset actually doesn't do that. The first century Middle Eastern mindset, they'll look at the scripture and go, they'll not understand something, they'll call them to dance with joy. Because God is about to show them something they haven't known before. God is about to teach them something. Sometime in the future, they're going to get an understanding of this and they're going to learn something new about who God is. You see the difference? They see the same problem we see, just with our Western mindset, we like everything to be, you know, spelled out and to make sense to us. But this Middle Eastern mindset, this sort of first century Middle Eastern mindset, they don't do that. They get excited. God, something great. In some time down the future, maybe through a friend or maybe through some extra study, I'm going to find out something new. So instead, they're excited, invigorated by what they don't understand. We've got to get a bit Middle Eastern in our thinking. Now, interestingly, Jesus mentioned this as well. Again, this is another podcast that I opened up and listened to. God speaking to me, maybe speaking for us. Matthew 13:10. The disciples came to him and asked, why do you speak to people in parables? Why don't you just say it straight, Jesus? Why do you speak in parables? Just say it straight. If you want us to do this, just say it straight. Why do you use parables all the time? He replied, verse 11, because the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of heaven has been given to you. But look at this little bit. But not to them. Whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. This is why I speak in parables. Though seeing, they do not see. Though hearing, they do not hear or understand. In them is the fulfilled prophecy of prophecy of Isaiah. Man, I'm so saying that sentence. In them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah. You will be ever hearing but never understanding. You will be ever seeing but never conceiving. For this is important. For this people's heart has become callous. They hardly hear their ears. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and feel. Jesus is drawing a distinction here. I tell my parables, my teaching moments, Jesus said, my message. I tell it to everyone. Everyone can hear. Everyone can see. Which is
There's no place for anyone. Doesn't matter who you are, where you come from, what kind of accent you have, or anything. I'm going to
roll. Why don't? In fact, let's get rid of it.
Doesn't have to be Jesus listening to you.
But then what is the distinction of Jesus listening to you? We need to get to Psalm 115, so I'll just say this straight and simple. Though I think we spend much more time, we could spend that more time exploring these things. The distinction is not in the message, but in the heart of the listener. On the one hand, there are those who have calloused their heart. You get calluses by rubbing against stuff, right? Joe's got calluses on his hands from all the bouldering rock climbing he's been doing for the last couple of weeks. I started to as well, and my fingers are now sore, but I don't do as well now. You get calluses from doing things over and over again, right? They've got a callous heart. They see, they hear, but it's like their eyes are closed, like they put fingers in their ears. They don't really want to know what Jesus is saying, which can be because of all kinds of reasons, but the end result of this saying. They hardly hear with their ears. They have closed their eyes.
That's a problem, isn't it? Because you've got something
And when? Because Jesus actually really wants these people to hear. He wants these people to see. He recognizes that their heart is calloused. Jesus wants to know. Because he says to say he's doing it, but he wants to know. All that was set up how to read Psalm 115. We really have to read it. We've got to become a little bit more Middle Eastern in the faith. We've got to get excited about trying to fully hear and fully see what that is. Psalm 115, not to us, not to us, but to your land of the glory, to the glory of the Lord. I'm going to cut myself short and then we just catch one more time. Psalm 115, because of your love and faithfulness. You know, we could read this wrong, and it's just for you over at history, we could read this wrong. We could read it all from wrong. The one really wrong way to read this thing. Not to us, not to us, but your name be the glory, and then you will give me your faithful love and kindness. That's not what it says, right? But we could think that, couldn't we? If we just give God to the glory, then he'll pour out his love on us, and then he'll pour out his faithfulness on us. If we would just give him the glory, that's what will happen, right? But that's not what the scripture says. It says, not through us, Lord, but not through us, but your name is the glory, because of what can we do? In love and faithfulness. Because in love and faithfulness. Because of your great love. This word love is fascinating. What do you mean by love when you see that word love? I mean, I think if you've been in the church long enough, you'll see that word love on your way. It could mean a whole lot of things. Because of your love, and is it love like a father to a daughter? Is it love like a brother to a sister? Is it love like friend to a friend? Is it love like me to a hamburger? Is it love? Is it love to me in money? Is it love to me in pleasure? Is it the same sort of thing? What kind of love are we talking about here? It's a Hebrew word, and I'm going to pronounce it wrong, but it's like something like chesed. Great word, right? Love Hebrew words. Chesed. Maybe if you wrote it in English, K-H-E-S-E-D. All right. Now, I'm no Hebrew expert, so I did some research from a Hebrew expert, and I found out some interesting things about this word love. And it's not love, it's love, but it actually encompasses lots of things all in one word. It encompasses generosity. So you could use the word generosity because of your generosity. There's more. It encompasses also this kind of loyal faithfulness. In other words, so the kind of love a parent has for a child It doesn't actually, really, you don't listen to them. It doesn't matter what my kids do, I will never stop loving them. You didn't hear me say anything, just move on. You didn't hear that. You only heard things like, if I'm good, then my dad will love me. No, you did. But isn't it true that we love our children no matter what? I know that there's some damaging things that have happened between fathers and sons. But I want to talk about in the general sense and in the way that it should be. You was embarrassed, you know, your children were lonely. There's just no way you can break the love of parents. It's impossible to break. At least in my view. Now, that doesn't mean I won't one day get very badly hurt by my children. They decide to do things that aren't important. I couldn't be hurt unless they loved me. Because I didn't love them, whatever they did, it was nothing. So that's what this loyal love is in there as well. God has this love for us that is not only generous, but outpouring of the self. But it's loyal that goes beyond no matter what actions. This word has said captures this thought. It's loyal no matter what will you do. That's the kind of God that we have. And then I always thought that was funny because the other option was wrong. I'm like, that doesn't help. But it encompasses all these ideas into one. Very difficult word to translate from Hebrew to any other language. And so in English we use the word love. See what I mean? I kind of just love this idea of digging a little deeper and explore what something means. If we can dig a little deeper, explore what that means a little harder, our ears begin to open, our eyes become open, we begin to see with our eyes and hear with our ears, and Jesus saves us. Jesus heals us. Same word in the New Testament, save and heal. Same word. All right. Jesus, we thank you for bringing us all in this room together. Young, old, there's no one else. Young and slightly young, less young. God, thank you that you brought people from all over the world into this one room for this moment, for this day. And we go and thank you for the individual community. That over all of my 47 years, you walked the left foot up, down, up and forward, and risen. I'm going to go to the next one. Week, everybody. Looking forward to seeing you next week for our launching into Vision 2024. Hey, thanks, you guys. Stick around for a coffee or a tea. Love to have a. I can make you a coffee. If you want? Maybe I'll jump in and make coffee for you. You never know. Bless you guys. Have a great week.